My name is Dr. Wen Guan with Up2Us Sports. I serve as the National Director for Research and Evaluation. And I've been privileged enough to be given the opportunity to coordinate these Lunch and Learn series. And so through these Lunch and Learn sessions, we aim to foster a space for all of us upstream and downstream to join together, share and learn from each other, and to highlight the incredible work from our partners. And so for those joining us for the first time, I want to give you a quick introduction to our organization, Up2Us Sports. We're a national nonprofit focusing on the power of sports-based youth development. And we do that through our SBYD, Sports-Based Youth Development Training Program, and our AmeriCorps Coach and VISTA Capacity Building Programs. So supporting our coaches and VISTAs to maximize their impact on youth and communities is the center of our work, which is why this is a perfect segue to the topic of our discussion today, achieving and maintaining emotional wellness for people who serve. And so, as y'all heard earlier, this session will be facilitated by the amazing Dr. Dawn Brown. Dr. Brown's a national acclaimed child, adolescent, adult, and sports psychiatrist. Dr. Brown is a two-time best-selling author, a Forbes writer, blogger, podcaster, producer, keynote speaker, and media influencer, among other things, of course. Much of her work is focused on the intersection of sports and mental health, particularly related to elite athletes. Dr. Brown has an MD from St. Louis University School of Medicine, where she also completed her adult psychiatry residency. And so before I hand it off to Dr. Brown, I'd like to mention that there will be an interactive component to this session. And so we encourage your participation, but we also acknowledge that not everyone may be in that space. So if you're here to just listen, we simply ask that you put an asterisk at the front of your name for our information when it comes time to creating breakout rooms. So thank you again, everyone, for joining us today. And let's all give a warm welcome to Dr. Dawn Brown.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here. Are you all able to see me okay now?
We still can't see your camera, but we can definitely hear you.
All right. Technology is good when it works. How about now? Can you see that okay?
No, unfortunately not.
Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to get out of my PowerPoint. I'm going to come right back in. Thank you for that warm introduction, Dr. Guan. And I'll be right back, I promise you.
Okay. That sounds good.
Thank you for your patience, everyone.
No problem. So while Dr. Brown is working on that, let's do a quick, have we done like a little quick 1 to 5 how we're doing today? So this is something Up2Us Sports loves to do. 5 being doing very, very well, and the opposite for 1. If you wanna just hold your finger up or type it in the chat. How are y'all doing today? Quick check-in. Nice, lots of 4s, lots of 5s actually, amazing. Dr. Brown, we see you.
Hi everybody, how are you?
There she goes.
We learn how to pivot, don't we?
Yeah.
It's good to see everybody. Dr. Guan, thank you so much for that warm introduction. I really do appreciate it. It's truly an honor and a privilege to be here today. So I'm actually gonna go ahead and share my screen here. And we're gonna get right into it. All right, can everyone see that?
What is your why?
Right. So are you all able to comment in the comment section? I saw someone comment earlier.
Yep, we're all in the chat.
So I asked this question to you, what is your why? I want you to think about that. You know, when I think about our whys, right? Or I think about my why, I think about my calling, my conviction. Right? It's my mission statement, okay? It's the vision of my life work. It's the thread of our story, our community, our careers. It's the core source of our motivation. It's the reference point for all of the decisions that you make in life. It defines who you are and what makes you productive. It's your purpose. It's the reason for your life's work, right? So what is your why? Can you go ahead and put your whys in the chat for me? I want to get an understanding what your why is. Okay. All right. What are your whys? Make the world a better place through sport. Yes. Anyone else? Giving back to the community. All right. Building meaningful and fulfilling relationships with people around the world to help others. Okay. All right. To open doors. Thank you all for sharing that. Thank you. So it's interesting that I asked that question. Because when we think about what your why is, it's a statement of purpose that describes why you do what you do, the work that you do, and why you live the lifestyle you live, right? And when we think about this, I want you to think about why you chose to do what you're doing right now. And so many of you have already made that kind of plain to me in the comment section, to make the world a better place, to give back to the community through sports, to help others. I saw that, right? And so when I think about this, and when you think about this, I want you to think about where your why comes from. Anyone know where their why comes from? Your why comes from within you. Comes from within you. And when I think about that, I like to always realize that, you know, it's challenging to think about this why, because when I say it becomes within you, it's our own innate abilities. It's our talents, our gifts, right? So when we think about our why, or when I think about why, I think about purpose. And when I think about purpose, I think about purpose equals gifts plus passion. And gifts are our innate abilities. They're God-given talents, right? It's what we can't teach others to do. We just do so well. And our passions are what drives us. We don't have to get paid to do it. We love what we do, all right? So when you combine those two, we actually bring about a person's purpose. And so that's how I think about what a why is and how it comes from within us. So I ask you, when I think about the why and I think about the heroes that I'm speaking to today in this virtual space, I think about the people who dedicated their lives to nonprofit organization, to help others, to serve others, to make this world a better place through sports, through community, through purpose. I call you all heroes. And when I think about a hero, even the heroes can get off the balance beam from time. They can get off the road at times as well. And sometimes it's hard to get back on, because sometimes that line becomes blurred. It becomes difficult to understand when you're off the road and when you're on the road, because you're always in that hero role, right? So I'm asking you today, as a hero, who takes care of you? And that's what we're gonna focus on today for the time I have with you, all right? So my name is Dr. Dawn Brown. Again, Dr. Guan, thank you so much for having me. I am a double board child, adolescent, adult, and sports psychiatrist. I'm from Flint, Michigan. I currently reside in Houston, Texas. And I love what I do. I do. But even I have to always go back and make sure my lines are not blurred. Sometimes people refer to me as their heroes when I don't feel like it. And my emotional wellness is what keeps me afloat. It's what keeps me balanced. And so that's what we're going to talk about today. For some of you, maintaining that. For others, needing to achieve that. We're going to talk about both, especially for the role that you serve. And that is people, all right? I am a serial entrepreneur. I do a lot of my work through telehealth, telepsychiatry. I own three businesses. I'm in the process of expanding two of those businesses to help others, to make the world a better place through mental health and awareness, education, treatment, destigmatizing mental health experiences. And my mental health athletics is who I'm here representing today. I actually serve a group of elite athletes, whether they be professional, collegiate, retired, and even Olympians. These are my whys. These are part of my whys, if you will, in creating a different narrative for mental health for athletes, because I recognize them as a human first who just happen to be athletic, okay? And so I do a lot of things. I have a live show, I have a podcast, I've written books. I serve super moms, moms who parent children with ADHD. I'm an influencer, content creator. I just love mental health and I love every aspect of it. And again, I love serving just like you. And so when I present myself as vulnerable as I can, there are times where it can get lonely. There are times where it can become overwhelming because I'm constantly giving to others. And so when we talk about your organization, right, there is a mission statement that I saw on your website. And that mission statement was actually referenced in the comment section of someone's kind of their why. It's to engage, train, support sports coaches and to transform youth programs and communities. Actually, a couple of you actually referenced as part of this mission statement for Up2Us Sports. And so when I think about your organization, this is one word that I'm going to use today because this is a role that is often described as to what we do, right? It's the definitions within the word. We are caregivers. We love giving. We love caring. And so that makes our role very unique, very special. And it's a privilege, right? What do we like? Why do we like giving to others? It allows us to have self-worth. It allows us to feel good, right? It creates happiness and joy in someone else's life. It allows someone to have hope. You know, caregiving is a lot of things. And it also requires a lot of things as well. And so as a caregiver, you know, when we look at this, the simple definition is that, and I highlighted these words, particularly for a reason, a family member or a paid helper who regularly looks to care for a child or a sick, elderly, or even a disabled person, right? And so when we look at this word, let's look at it a little bit closer. I, in the word caregiver, usually when we're talking about a caregiver in the pronoun I, it's in the middle of the word, right? But figuratively, when we're talking about caregiver, usually I, meaning you, meaning me, meaning Sherman or Dr. Guan, we are individuals that are often left to the last place of our caregiver task. Why do you think that is? Why do you think that is? As a caregiver, our priority has been giving to others while serving ourselves last. And so today, I would like to change that narrative. If that's kind of the mindset and perspective, I actually like to challenge it for you to see if you are open to redefining your caregiver role. So there's a poll that I have for you. How many dimensions of wellness are there? And you can go ahead and put that in the chat as well. How many dimensions of wellness do you think there are? Oh, thank you, Dr. Guan. All right. All right, so do I just answer this, Dr. Guan? Do I answer the poll here?
I don't think so. I think co-hosts may not be able to. Oh, you can answer.
Okay, I can answer. All right. There are eight, you all. There are eight dimensions of wellness. All right, I see Sherman lift his hands up. I see Sherman, I see Katie, I see Daniel. I don't see everyone else, but guess what? I'm gonna come to you. I'll come to you, all right? There are eight dimensions of wellness, right? But oftentimes in school, in family lifestyles, even in our homes, we're often taught to focus on our mental health and our physical health, two dimensions. So today I'm challenging you today to understand there are really eight. There are eight dimensions of health. There's physical health, there's social health, occupational, financial, environmental, spiritual, intellectual, and emotional. So all of these dimensions of health make up our mental health, if you will. All right. And they add and contribute their own variances to creating stability for our mental health or wellness, if you will. All right. So when I think about emotional health, you know, emotional health is on a spectrum. Everyone has emotional health. Everyone has abilities to overcome certain circumstances, achieve and conquer certain situations that might've been stressful, right? Conquer things that you often were self-defeated for when you lost the previous time and you won this time, right? We often achieve success. And how do we know we're successful? Why does it feel so good? Because there are times where we lose or we don't necessarily make the goal, right? So emotional health is a spectrum. And there's different degrees and levels to our emotional health, not just with levels, acute, meaning, you know, short-term, long-term, or even throughout the course of our lives. It's a continuum, right? So I like this picture because it actually explains our emotional health using faces, sadness, surprise, anger, happiness, joy. You know, all of these things are a part of our emotional wellness. And when I ask you as a caregiver that, you know, it's easy to give, right? It's easy to be able to pour into other people's lives and underserved communities and people who have lack of access to certain services, to deal with what they're dealing with, and it becomes our own situation or challenge. There's a time and a place and a reason, I say, that at some point we're going to actually have an empty cup. There's just no more, there's much more to give. And it's hard to pour from an empty cup. And so when I talk about prioritizing people and themselves, they're usually surprised by that, especially the caregiver that you are. It's often a person that is often thinking about themselves first, how they can change the world, how they can change the world through sports, how they can actually make a difference in someone else's lives. But in any of those examples, and they're wonderful examples that you all gave me to your why, I don't think I saw anyone that said something about them using the word I. And we have to change that. It's not selfish at all. It's okay to make yourself first. It's okay to have selfish moments, even if you want to consider it selfish. And our society doesn't teach us that way. It actually teaches against that. But there's an alternative to having an empty cup. There's also a such thing as overfilling or overpouring or being exhausted or overwhelmed, right? A lot of caregivers have gallons of love to give, but many of the people that we give to have pint-sized portions to receive it. So what do we do? What do you do, Dr. Dawn? You know, when I have so much to give to the world and so much to give to these kids that we serve and so much to give to these coaches that we're helping serve others in communities that have lack of resources, that, you know, they have the funding, they don't, you know, they have mental illnesses that are preventing them from playing sports or physical ailments, they're disabled. Like, what do we do? How do I, as a caregiver, working for a nonprofit, you know, provide what I know is my purpose, my passions and my gifts to a community when I have a lot to give, but they can't receive it? Well, you show up every time, you give yourself grace, you do your best, and you start all over again. That's what I encourage you to do, because it can be very frustrating for anyone to be in this caregiving role that serves your purpose and not to be able to provide what you've been born to do. I want to ask you another question here, because when I talk about caregiving and I talk about overpouring and, you know, can't filling or you can't give from an empty cup, right? A lot of times I think about the word stress. And when we think about stress is the number one killer in our society. It's associated with cardiovascular or myocardial disease. It's the number one killer in our society. People are stressed out, right? And stress comes to us in different ways. But my question to you is, of the following options, what is your favorite outlet to help you relieve your stress? For some of you, some of your favorites may not be on here, but I want you to be able to choose from the following eight options that I've given to you here. What is your favorite outlet to help relieve stress? All right, good. So exercise and running, which is wonderful. Your doctor will love you. We want to make sure that number one killer is in good condition, right? The cardiovascular events, that we are not at risk, even if you have a family history or unhealthy habits of living. You know, exercise is really good for stress, not just for mental stress, but also physical stress. It helps relieve anxiety, helps prevent depression. It helps create energy levels, right? It also takes a temporary, I would say, glimpse away from the pressures that of the world that you are often projected to. But I love the second choice option. The most common option is vacation. You know, it's interesting because when I talk to professionals or, you know, that I serve on a common basis, executives, a lot of them don't even take vacations. A lot of them don't even know what vacations are. A lot of them have vacations when they have conferences and they just invite their families and they still work. So I love the fact that you all take vacations. And it's not unusual that when I speak with nonprofits that they really do cherish the vacations. And that actually gives me good hope because a lot of times when I look at the traits of a caregiver that works for a nonprofit, they definitely value and understand how important it is to balance. So I may be preaching to some of you today, the choir, I may say, I may be preaching to the choir, but hopefully it's a friendly reminder, even if I am, because emotional wellness is very important. Emotional wellness is how we think, how we are able to manage our emotions, despite what challenges, external, internal challenges we may be facing or dealing with. But emotional wellness is different from mental wellness or illness, if you will. So emotional wellness equals mental health in this case. And it's definitely different from mental illness. Everyone has mental health, right? Everyone has an understanding of what their mental well-being is. Remember, I said it's a continuum, it's a spectrum. It's different levels and different times and periods of our lives. And again, it's the different degrees of health, right? So you can have poor mental health, but also have some type of mental illness. You can also have no mental illness, but also be in good mental health. The thing about mental illness, however, is that it actually interferes with their ability to function. It actually deprives a person of functioning at their optimal level. Depression, anxiety, post-traumatic stress disorder, these are common conditions of mental illnesses that are often treated so that your functioning, your ability to thrive and survive whatever is in front of you is able to be achieved. So mental illness is definitely different from mental health. And so it's kind of like having fingernails on a chalkboard. Whenever I see media talk about mental illness, that person must have a mental illness and crime committed must have had mental illness. And I'm speaking to you all because I know that you often deal with underserved populations that are unfortunately, they're at high risk of developing these mental health issues or illnesses, if you will, for so many reasons, right? For so many unjust, inequitable reasons. But it's important to understand that mental health is different from mental illness. And even people with mental illnesses are not necessarily people who commit the crimes that we're seeing on TV. Actually, less than 3% of those who commit crimes have a recognized mental illness, right? So that's, I want to spend a little bit of time on this slide because it's important to recognize mental health and how every person here is dealing with their emotional wellness and mental health. So again, emotional wellness, it's coping effectively with your life. It's satisfying the relationships, the people that mean much to you, that bring joy to your life. It's about listening to your feelings, listening to your body, listening to your thoughts, your mindset, expressing to people that you trust, that you love them, and that, you know, expressing feelings, you know, that you're feeling too, to people that you trust. And it's okay to do that. That's called vulnerability. And there's strength and vulnerability because it also often reminds yourself that you are human and you're still dealing with things that other people deal with. And it also helps you maintain a positive emotional outlook. So when we have stable or I would say a thriving emotional wellness, all these things are able to be achieved. All these things are in practice. However, as a caregiver, this is what we call you, my heroes here, there are also negative consequences on emotional wellness for us. you know, we have higher rates of depression and anxiety. We are likely to suffer from substance abuse disorders, drug, alcohol, cannabis, marijuana. We're often to suffer in silence, right? Because that giving role, we're often pouring to others. And a lot of times that's where we find our balance as well, in pouring into others instead of refueling our own cups. You know, we have lower levels of stress, or excuse me, of life satisfaction. And we can often project this onto others by exhibiting irritability, hostility, frustrations to others. And we just don't take good care of ourselves. Now, I don't know if I'm speaking to someone here in the virtual space that actually sees themselves on the screen here when I'm describing their current emotional health and wellness. But I'm here to hear today to give you hope and encourage you that today you can make a change for this. You can turn things around for yourselves. And it's important that you do that. One, because of the people you serve, yes. But my primary reason to be here today is because of you. And it's important that not only you do it for your work, but you do it for your health and your own life. So what are the signs of stress, right? Well, some of the people that I see as a psychiatrist, they've actually come to me after they've had their heart attack or their stroke. They've come to me after they lost 4 or 5 jobs or they're, you know, on their third marriage. Oftentimes people come to me when they've tried other paths in trying to deal with life stress. Rarely do I have someone come to me when they're, you know, losing their hair or they can't sleep well or they feel fatigued. They feel tired, they're exhausted. That's rare for me to even hear about. I often hear the extremes when I'm talking about patients and that I serve in clinics and also in my private practice. But I wanna give you an idea of what stress is, because it's different things for different people. It can feel overwhelming. It can feel like your heart is beating fast, your palms are very sweaty. You can lose interest in what you typically like to do and what you enjoy. There's a sense of sadness and there's no reason for it. You can't find a justified reason why you're feeling sad. It's not waking up on the wrong side of the bed. It's part of stress. Oftentimes it can be caused by or temporarily alleviated by substances, right? Or the perception is it can be alleviated by substances. But you know, alcohol is a depressant. And so it actually further perpetuates stress. It's like depression and stress are evil twins walking down the street. When one happens, the other can occur as well. It's often found in our losing weight or gaining weight, overeating, couch potatoes here, feeling tired, fatigued, becoming easily agitated and irritable and not understanding why. So these are signs of stress. And when I think about being an optimist, because that's generally what I am, I'm in the middle of the road there. I'm the middle cup usually. But oftentimes during this pandemic, I found myself to be the first cup. And that's not a bad thing. It shows a cup or a glass, an empty glass, that's what it shows. And the other two is, you know, half empty or full, right? And so when I think about optimism and pessimism and those two differences, the cup being half empty, half full, it's good to have those perceptions. It's good to justify and understand what they are to whatever particular situation you're discussing. But how about instead of looking at the cup half empty or half full, we just appreciate we have a cup to fill. And that's what I think about when I think about what's realistic for us, what's realistic for our roles, right? And the roles that we play in the lives of others. And if we want to make that change that someone had commented on in the world, if we want to leave our footprint, our mark on the world, what does that mean? What do we need to achieve in order to appreciate that? Well, oftentimes, again, that I and caregiver, yes, it's often in the middle of the word, right? It is in the middle of the word, but figuratively, it's often left out when we consider the roles of being a caregiver. So my recommendations on how you can achieve and maintain emotional health and wellness, and who to start with is gonna be you. We have to learn how to prioritize ourselves first. You have to be the priority in order to be the best caregiver you can be. Again, how can you pour from an empty cup if you do not refuel, replenish, revive, right? All the things that you've been depleted with or from and serving others. You have to take care of you first. And that comes in recognizing when you're tired, recognizing when your hair's falling out, recognizing that I'm just overwhelmed and I have to take my vacation, or it's time for me to work out. It's time to have my 15-minute break that I rightfully deserve in the middle of my day that I normally don't take. You have to recognize your body and your mind, and when it's telling you, it's really trying to communicate to you that it's stressed. Express your feelings. Be able to express your feelings in appropriate ways. What I mean by that is be able to look and step back and understand what you're feeling and communicate what you're feeling to someone that you love and trust, or even a therapist. That's important as well. All right. And think before you act. Oftentimes we don't necessarily do that. It's called impulsivity. Oftentimes we work more, we give more in order to relieve stress. I don't know how that's relieving stress if you're already overwhelmed, if you already gave a lot. Think before you act. Understand that your thoughts connect to your emotions. And if your emotions are telling you you're overwhelmed, you're tired, understand that that relates to, okay, Dawn, stop. Take a break, take a vacation. It's okay. You know, we'll regroup and they'll be here when we get back. And let them know, plan ahead of time. Strive for balance. You know, those eight dimensions of wellness that I showed you on the screen there. It's important to balance all of those things. Emotional wellness, I believe it starts with emotional wellness. I truly do. Because we're often driven by our emotions, especially as caregivers, right? But it's also important to strive to be as balanced as you can. And how I consider balance, of course, our maker knows if we're balanced or not. I mean, you know, how do we function? How do we know we're functioning optimally? Well, most days of the week, we are successful in completing our tasks and the task reasonable. It's not like you're creating a 20-page list of things you have to do in 2 hours. We set ourselves up off too often. Take care of your physical health. Equally as important as taking care of your emotional health. A lot of you exercise and run, that's great. It's also good to meditate, right? To spend time in yoga, to take time to breathe. Even in the middle of the day, when things get rough, when you're working with a family that is just, you know, having a really bad time, right? It's okay to take time to breathe. That cramp in your neck will tell you it's okay. It's time for a massage. It's time to rest. Listen to your body. It often tells you what you need to hear, which is not doing it. And connect with others. There's many studies on connection. It's the most, I would say, the most common piece and the most optimistic and positive thing or item that we can do to survive. I actually been to different parts of Africa. And when I visited Cape Town, I was on there on a mission for mental health. And I asked one of the community members, okay, I don't see anyone, I don't see any mental health providers. I don't see any spiritual elders out here. Like, how do people live with, you know, what they're going through? And I already knew. I mean, I knew kind of the answer. Well, part of the answer. Part of the answer was that sometimes when you don't know, you don't know. Sometimes we value things that we're born in the societies that we're born into. And if we don't have an idea what else could be for us, we don't think about those things, right? Because we haven't experienced it. But that wasn't the point. I already knew that. What was recognized to me by a community member was that, do you look around? And I looked around and I did not see not one person alone. Someone was always with someone. They were connected in a sense. And so connection is so important. We know that in this pandemic, a lot of people have been disconnected from their routine, disconnected from each other, disconnected from their families, disconnected the unfortunate circumstance long-term as they lost loved ones during this pandemic, right? And so connection is so key. And it's so important that we are connected to others, especially when we're givers. Find purpose and meaning. If you lost your purpose, find it again. It's okay, it might have changed on you. A lot of times we get frustrated because we don't feel the joy that we used to feel. And sometimes that's not necessarily in us being tired. Sometimes we have to find a purpose again or repurpose our lives. And so it may be a different role within the same organization. It may be adding on another role in your life or a change up. But it's important to make sure that that is routinely evaluated for and stay positive, right? Optimism is also a healthy predictor to longevity. It actually creates hope. And when you're positive, you're creating your own hope. You're speaking to your own self. It's kind of like self-therapy. And it's realistic as well. You know, being optimistic is realistic because you attract what you're thinking about. You attract positivity when you think it. And so there's a lot of studies that show this. So stay positive. And get serious about laughing. I had to laugh today when I was late because I've never been late for a presentation. I was on a roll of always being early. But I have to take the time and laugh about these things, because oftentimes things happen outside of our control. And when you're dealing with communities on a daily basis where things are happening outside of their control and they have no idea of what else can happen, they don't know the hope that you know for them, that you have for them. It's important to create laughter. Laughter is a mature defense. It's not necessarily about nervousness. It's about being able to release nervousness. That's what laughing is about as well. So there's a difference between happiness and joy. And oftentimes, you know, I ask people, are you happy or are you joy? Do you have joy? And, you know, it's interesting how a lot of people in our world think about happiness and joy. Some people think they're interchangeable. Some people have stated, I'm happy, you know, and they tell me the reasons why they're happy. And oftentimes it's, you know, someone in their life is doing well or their health is doing well for themselves and so on and so forth. But, you know, happiness is based off of happenings. And so a lot of times happiness is not there. But I often like to think that it's the joy that keeps us going. It's the joy that keeps us as being a priority in our lives. It's the joy that keeps us going back to the people that we serve. It's the joy that refuels us over and over again to continue to do the jobs that we do very well. It's the joy that keeps you going. And I find joy as being defined as inner happiness. So regardless of the sadness or the good days that are going outside, right? Regardless of the external stressors that you may be experiencing, no one can steal your joy. No one can take that away. So part of your why should be the joy you find in life, because that's internal. And that's something that should often be protected. True or false? People who have good emotional health can still have emotional problems, mental illness. True or false? All right. Awesome. You would be surprised. This is actually the first presentation. I've actually used this same question when I talk about mental health in other presentations. And this is the first where I've had 100% say that it's true. All right. So it appears as though, and it's, no, I have proof right here, that you all have a really good understanding of emotional wellness, of emotional health, that you can still deal with mental illness from time to time, right? And it's important to, again, identify when your mind and your body are telling you to slow down, pay attention to me, I'm too tired, I don't wanna do this again, all right? I don't have the capacity right now. And when you listen to your mind and your body, you can appreciate the other things that need to happen in your life. The caregiver role is not necessarily just seen in the work that we do. It's also seen in who we are to other people that are at home, in our lives, right? Family, extended family members, in our friendships, right? In our social circles. So a lot of times it's not just about giving at work. You're often giving in other facets of your life. So when do we turn that off? When do we turn it off? When does someone give to you? The hardest part of being a caregiver that I find people experience is that it's hard for them to have people give to them. Is that hard for anybody here? Is it hard for you to accept the fact that someone wants to do something for you for once? To buy you dinner, to clean up your house for you, to take you out and to go dancing, to take over a tedious task? Is it hard for you to receive compliments about the work you've done in the communities that you serve, from people that you serve? We have to do a reality check, all right? Because we're doing ourselves a disservice when we're not actually caring for ourselves. And that should always be the number one person we care for. It's not selfish. It's not selfish at all. It's actually something that is courageous to do, but it's the right thing to do. And it's the healthiest thing to do. Because again, how can you give to others when you haven't even given to yourself? Now, I understand some people here in this virtual space are able to appreciate that. But there are some people here today that are not necessarily there, that may be experiencing a mental illness themselves, that haven't disclosed this to anyone, that are suffering in silence, as caregivers often do. They don't talk about it because other people's problems, especially people I serve, they're probably, you know, they're dealing with more than I'm dealing with. So I'm, you know, you often minimize your own frailties, but the thing is you're human. So I have to say this, we have to start talking about it, which is why I'm here today. I'm not here today to tell you how to do your job better. I'm not here today to give you insight as a psychiatrist from my perspective, how I can give you hope in making better coaches and making, you know, performances of players better and on all those things. I'm here today for you. And I appreciate Dr. Nguyen allowing me to have a different type of presentation for you today. And I will be here in smaller circles and more intimate circles for whoever wants to stay after. If all of you want to, let's do it. Because we need to start having intimate conversations about what it means to care for yourself. A lot of people, who's taught this in school? We're not taught this. We're not taught this. We're not taught this in our different cultural backgrounds or families. We're not. We're taught to care for others first before we care for ourselves. And we find jobs that allow us to do it. But we also, like entrepreneurs, have to turn it off because we're often caregivers to everybody, with the exception to ourselves. So instead of, to talking about it, let's create an action plan. I'm just gonna be real with you. I'm not ever sick of talking about it, but I'm all about mobilizing an action plan. And I'm here today to help you mobilize an action plan. If you're struggling with creating a plan or creating or being intentional about producing a plan and definitely acting on it. So there's counselors, support groups, people in the mental health field that you can talk to, social workers are available. I will definitely give Dr. Nguyen some of my recommendations, free services, clinics all across our country, especially since the pandemic has happened. I mean, I serve 5 clinics online myself. And these are services that are provided for you whenever you need someone to talk to. If you have a problem and it's ongoing, and it's even to the point where it's become suicidal thoughts, please talk to someone, tell someone. We often talk to people who understand us or who's close to us, but it's also okay to talk to someone who you don't know, but is a professional who can help you manage it. And so that's a therapist, it's a psychiatrist, it's a counselor, it's a person that is here for you, all right? 1 in 10 people in June of 2020 experienced suicidal thoughts in our world, 1 in 10. So I'm in a room of what, 60 people, let's say, at least 6 of you experienced suicidal thoughts at some point during the past 12 months. Humbling. So again, it's important to care for ourselves first. I wanted to show you my whys. These are my whys. And when I often talk about my whys, probably all the time, 100% of the time now, because I used to not be here, I always start with me, because we have to develop a sense of understanding and appreciating that we are important. You're important. It's okay to take care of you first, so that you can take care of others. In order for others and the people that depend on you to be at their best, you have to be at yours. All right. You are able to find me. Here's my website. I'm always found on social media platforms. It's Dr. Dawn Psych, MD. Dr. Nguyen has my information. I'm here for you all. I really am. And I would love to have more ongoing conversations about the importance of emotional wellness, your emotional wellness, and how you could be better caregivers for yourselves. Thank you for your time today.
Thank you, Dr. Brown. We have about 10 to 12 minutes before we close for a session. Thank you so much, Dr. Brown. Would you be able to answer some questions if folks have any?
I'm here. Wonderful. I'm here. I'm available at 2 p.m. So however, I want to make sure I'm here for you all today. Yes.
Thank you. So if you have any questions, feel free to unmute and let's hear them.
You're welcome. My pleasure.
I have a question. Dr. Brown, thanks for that presentation. Yes. You know, one of the things I think you ended with talking about action. And so I was looking, I took a screenshot of your slide, how to achieve and maintain good emotional health. Be aware of your emotions and reactions, express your feelings, think before you act. You know, my sense is that we're asking a lot of people in a culture in which being psychological isn't really promoted. In other words, it's almost like with physical health, right? We tell people exercise, do all these things, don't be reactive, don't wait to get to the doctor. But I think of James Hollis, the Jungian analyst, who talked about one of the most important things to be is to live psychologically. But we don't teach human beings how to live psychologically. People don't know what the difference between the unconscious and conscious, what's conscious and unconscious, so we're asking a lot of people we live in a culture in which we don't promote living psychologically. So I'm curious, do you have thoughts about, you know, yes, we have helplines for people, we have things like that, but it's kind of late in the game a lot of times for folks. And so if parents aren't doing it, schools aren't doing it, do you have thoughts about how a culture begins? It's obvious part of the work we're trying to do with our coaches, right? So these are folks who are getting, you know, hoping to put a resource in the lives of kids to help them live psychologically, right? To build up self-esteem, yes. To build up these attributes that hopefully will help them live psychologically. But I'm curious, do you have thoughts as a practicing psychiatrist about how we might start to move a society towards teaching kids to live psychologically so they can do the things we're asking them to do, and adults too, right? Because if the adults aren't healthy, you know what that means. The kids aren't gonna be healthy. So just thoughts on that.
Yes, Mario, thank you so much for that question. It's a very good question. I honestly would say we have to model it. We have to model it. And that's why I'm here, to make sure that you're caring for yourselves first. Because you're right, if we're dealing with families and the adults are not necessarily doing things in a healthy manner, I mean, that's where the kids are growing up. And that's their sense of normalcy. They don't know anything else, right? And oftentimes stress can become traumatic. And trauma doesn't shut off and on. It just gets worse and worse for so many people. So one of the ideals that I have is that we have to model. We have to model it for ourselves. We have to tell people, you know, yes, I'm able to help you, but I am not available at this time. Or I don't have the capacity to be able to do this right now. But guess what? We can work on this at another time. Even in modeling the caregiver role and not necessarily giving, but creating boundaries. Because the interesting phenomenon about what you've asked is that our behaviors are often thrived off of psychology. Psychology is in marketing. It's on TV, it's in magazines, it's buy this now, it's in the value meal product, right? Psychology is used in everything that we do. It actually gets us moving and acting. But when it comes to healthy behaviors, when it comes to justifying psychological health and wellness, oftentimes we're not driven by that. It's too hard. It's too costly. I can't buy the foods that are going to help my mental health capacity be at its best. You know, I have too much work to do. I'm a single parent and I don't have time to be able to tend to this child's needs, you know, when I'm dealing with all these other kids that can't help themselves either. It's overwhelming. And so a lot of times we have to be able to model that. And when you model that for the parents, you actually give them hope as an adult, because what you're giving them is another way, and you're inviting them to see another way and being able to do things. Now, of course, if they don't have the access or the means, that's going to be difficult. But I'm talking about psychology of hope. And sometimes that means we have to be vulnerable to that. And vulnerability is not a bad thing. It's about giving examples of our life circumstances and being able to connect. But it's not about us either. It's also about listening to what their needs are and then being able to meet them where they are. So I'm giving you different references: modeling, meeting people where they are, using ourselves and being vulnerable, right? All of these things can be helpful when you're talking about teaching healthy emotional wellness to a population that's at risk of not having it. And it depends on how they're receiving it. That's gonna make the difference. And you're really good at doing that, Mario. That's why you're doing what you do. And you're right. Our society, like I said, you know, and I agree with you. Our society teaches us the exact opposite. But again, if we start modeling it and putting ourselves first and create these boundaries, if you will, in taking breaks, taking vacations, knowing when your time, you know, you just don't have any more energy left. That's what we need to start doing. And that's what we need. I mean, we need to start doing it so we can actually model it for others to start doing it as well.
Is that all? I don't want to take up the time. So when, if there are other questions, I mean, I feel like, again, we talked about this when we had the social emotional learning sort of lunch and learn, which is, if you had healthy adults, if adults were living psychologically, then yes, of course, it'd be beautiful because they could model it. My point is, we have a culture, I think you just noted, in which the adults need the help too. I mean, so it's an interesting, fascinating sort of cultural and sociological question, because I don't think we prioritize. To your point, we live in a culture in which living psychologically really isn't promoted. And so across the board, buy this, do this, you know, God forbid you're being asked to go in deep, you know, to really think deeply about things. So, you know, down the road, I'm curious, you know, it'd be great to continue the conversation. And I'm sure others have other questions, Wynn. So I don't want to continue the process. But thank you, Dr. Brown.
For your
feedback.
Awesome. And I'll add to this. I mean, you can't give, it's hard to be able to teach someone something when they don't have the capacity for it. I mean, that's just plain and simple, right? So if someone is, like, for example, I'll take this case in point. If someone is depressed and they walk in my office, I sometimes feel their depression. And it's hard for me to give them hope, because all they feel, all they see, all their senses is geared towards being depressed, right? But I focus on what brought them to the office. I focus on meeting people where they are. I find whatever that, you know, piece of the puzzle is, where it just allows me to have a little bit of a peek in their door and try to use that to open and see if I can help make a difference, right? So yes, you know, I get it. I mean, I'm from Flint, Michigan. I was raised in a community where, you know, it was very deprived. And, you know, my parents did their best in trying to create a society where I was actually I had access to things that many people didn't have access to. But I also have friends, and I keep in touch with them, who didn't have the same level of access, but found their way. And again, you know, if we just see that glimpse of hope and what led people to want to meet with you, Mario, we can start there. We can start there.
Wynn, that's all I have. Thanks, Dr. Brown. I didn't want to monopolize the conversation.
Oh, no, you're fine. It's an outstanding question. And I mean, and you know, I'm still talking because it's so challenging. There's really no one answer for it. And it's a very difficult, you know, topic to even, I wouldn't say discuss, but to have sound answers for, because everyone's situation is different. Every circumstance is different. But in I'm trying to generalize, you know, an answer that is just hard to do. You know what I mean? There's so many factors and levels to people's situations, in other words. Yeah. But I appreciate the question. Definitely.
Thank you, Dr. Brown. We do have time for one more question if anyone has another question.
No other questions here?
Okay. Well, okay. So.
I have a question.
Yeah.
out of a show of hands, how many people are feeling joy today? Okay. All right. So of the people that I can see, I know majority of you raised your hands and I know a couple didn't, right? So one of the things that I would love to come back if you will, if you have me, and talk about, you know, this ongoing questions of emotional wellness, because again, I touched on the surface. It's a huge topic. Mario, you brought up a wonderful question. And the thing about joy is that, again, it's internal. And in order for us to continue to do what we do well, in order for us to use the innate abilities that we've been given, in order for us to use the passions and being able to produce at our jobs, in our lives, you know, in our family and friendships, circles, we have to find that joy. And, you know, regardless of what's happening outside of us, regardless of who we're serving, you know, it doesn't necessarily equate to the joy we have internally. And so part of that joy, again, is making sure you find balance in your emotional wellness. Seriously, because it's really quick to get wrapped up in the world's issues and society and wanting to make the world better without putting yourself first. So I just encourage you to put yourself first, and I almost guarantee you the rest, you know, the rest will be easier for you to achieve, especially your whys.
Thank you so much, Dr. Brown. Thank you so, so much for this session. I just want to give a huge thank you once again, and let's just snaps for Dr. Brown for this session, sharing her experience, support, and guidance. We're going to drop a couple of social media handles in the chat. There's Dr. Brown's website, her Twitter handle. In addition, we also want to thank everyone for joining our Lunch and Learn series. Our next session will be June 23rd. We'll send more information out. You can follow our Twitter or Instagram to stay up to date. It will be focusing on a trauma-informed intervention to increase healthy eating and exercise in youth. And so we'll go in depth on that topic. But thank you once again, Dr. Brown, for facilitating this session. And I will follow up with everyone with an email with the recording of this session and any resources that Dr. Brown may want to provide as well. But once again, thank you. Have a great rest of your day.
Bye-bye, everyone. Thank you again. Thanks.